A nice warm welcome for you, Paul.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for attending the BLOE Energy corporate presentation. The company's focus is, as mentioned earlier, in Georgia. We've got an oil and gas portfolio with existing scalable production. We've got $39.3 million NPV10 attributed to our 2P net oil reserves. Additional potential from the 38 million barrels of contingent oil, and most important for the company is a 600 BCF contingent gas resource in West Vestavi, which has an estimated unrisked project value of circa $600 million, and that's at a 50% recovery rate. Analogous plays are being drilled by Schlumberger on adjacent permit. We're fully funded to recomplete 10 wells and perform sidetracks within our West Vestavi permit, increasing existing oil production from 15 barrels of oil a day beyond 900. The company's break-even number is 120 barrels of oil a day at $70 oil. Our major shareholder is Georgian Oil and Gas, who are not only an established operator and party to multiple production sharing contracts in country, but are also a drilling service provider. Some key data on the company. So BLOE is newly listed, having listed on AIM in June 2018. The company's ticker is BLOE. We've got 259 million shares on issue, and we're currently trading at a price of around 3.22p. We IPO'd at 4p, so today's trading price is a discount to our IPO price, which we believe offers significant value for new investors. We have a market cap of £8.34 million. The current share register is made up of Amati Global Investors, Georgian Oil and Gas, Pershing Nominees, which is the nominees used by professional investors and retail investors that entered at the IPO. Mighton Asset Management are in for 9.19%. Iskander Energy Corp and Man Energy are also shareholders. Moving on to the board and management, Mr. Philip Dimmock is the company's non-executive chairman. Philip is here today, so if anybody would like to speak to Philip after the event, please feel free. Myself, I'm the CEO of the company. I've been active in Georgia for the past 8 years, having been involved in the acquisition and development and sale of multiple assets in country. I know the above surface environment extremely well. Roger McMeehan is the company's technical director. Roger's got 30 plus years experience in the oil industry, having a specific focus on engineering recompletions of existing wells. He spent the better part of 5 years operating in Georgia and knows the subsurface environment extremely well. Roger's going to be leading BLOE's phase one work program going forward. The rest of the team consists of Serena Beera. She's our financial director. Serena spent the better part of 10 years working with AIM and ASX listed companies whilst working with BDO, previously with Falklands Oil and Gas. Niall Tomlinson is also a director of the company. Niall spent the better part of 4 years working with myself in Georgia evaluating opportunities and has pretty much assisted in building the portfolio in which you see within BLOE today. Tim Parsons is the company's non-executive director. Tim's been in the oil industry for many, many years, having spent 20 years of his nearly 40-year career within Schlumberger. Moving on to Georgia, does everybody know where Georgia is? Just making sure there's no Americans in the crowd, so confuse things. So Georgia obviously sits at the eastern part, the most eastern part of Europe, in between the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea. Its Siamese twin is Azerbaijan. It's separated by two major basins. You've got the Rioni Basin that runs down the centre of the country off to the west. And then you've got the Kora Basin that runs down from the centre of the country down into the east, into Azerbaijan. Georgia has made some significant improvements and significant reforms since 2003. And it's since submitted its application to join the European Union. It currently benefits from trade-related benefits, as well as freedom of movement for its people in and around the EU. From an infrastructure standpoint, Georgia is extremely well served in terms of oil and gas pipelines. You've got the Baku-Tbilisi-Cairn pipeline that runs through the centre of the country, transporting over 1.2 million barrels of oil a day, and is operated by BP. You've also got the SCP pipeline that transports Chardonnay's gas, again through the centre of the country. It's currently transporting around 20 million cubic metres of gas per day, and again is operated by BP. Now, looking at the area of interest, which is the area highlighted in yellow, I'm not sure if you guys at the back can see that, but that area within Georgia has produced pretty much 100% of its oil to date. Now, zoning in that area, you can see in the image below, block's positions are highlighted in red. A block has a 100% working interest in an Oreo oil field, a 90% working interest in Satskinesi, and is farming in for a 75% working interest in West Vestavi. Block 11B is currently held 100% by Schlumberger, who are the operator of that field and are currently drilling their first well. Block 11B has been the most prolific producer in country to date, having produced 70,000 barrels of oil at its time of peak production, which was in and around the mid-70s. Total production from that field is just over 210 million barrels of oil. Moving on to a little bit more detail on the assets. So Norio and Satskinesi were discovered fields back in the mid-60s. But since the breakup of the Soviet Union, there's a lot of unloved fields throughout Georgia. And Norio and Satskinesi were opportunities that were identified by myself and the rest of the team some years back. The fields to date have produced just over 2.1 million barrels of oil. They're currently producing 15 barrels of oil a day. Now, believe it or not, that's OPEX break-even for the company and covers our local G&A costs. We're running things on an extremely lean and mean basis in-country. Reserve potential sits at 1.1 million barrels of oil, 2P reserves, 32 million barrels of contingent resources, and over 240 million barrels of P50 oil in place. The production sharing contracts that govern the license areas are some of the best we've seen in country. Sorry, I'm getting an echo here.
Thank you. I'm tapping away because we've lost the mic.
Okay,
we're back. Everybody's quiet so we can hear you, but okay. Yes, sorry, it's just coming on.
We get to recover 100% of our operating costs before sharing any oil with the state, and thereafter we share oil on a 50-50 basis whilst in our cost recovery phase. The acquisition of the PSCs enabled Block to inherit a $20 million cost recovery pool, which we feel will be staying within the cost recovery period for at least the next 7 to 8 years. The immediate plan in Norio and Satskinesi is to enhance existing oil production with a view of increasing current production from 15 barrels a day up to around 250 barrels of oil a day. And as mentioned earlier, our break-even point is circa 120 barrels of oil at $70 oil. Moving on to West Vestavi, that we believe is somewhat the jewel of the crown within our portfolio. Again, West Vestavi is a proving oil field. Our tests have produced 41,000 barrels of oil to date. It sits contiguous to the largest discovery in country, within 10 kilometres. We've had 400,000 barrels of 2P reserves attributed to the Middle Eocene formation, which is, again, the most prolific producer in country. And we've got a contingent oil resource of just over 28 million barrels. Now, what's most interesting here and what's the bigger focus for the company going forward is the gas potential. We've tested gas from two wells, one of which located on the western edge of the permit and another of which located on the eastern side of the permit, which have contributed to the BCF gas potential that's being attributed by independent consultants. Net to Block, we've got over 456 BCF contingent gas resource that we're going to be chasing in Q4 and Q1 of next year. The immediate plan is to go back into existing well bores that have produced oil and gas, clean out those wells and prepare 2 or 5 wells for sidetracks. Immediate production target from West Vestavi is around 650 barrels of oil a day. In parallel to that work, we see ourselves retesting the gas discovery had in well number 30. Against the backdrop of Schlumberger appraising their gas discovery had in a neighbouring permit. I'd just like to spend a little bit of time on explaining exactly how we're going to exploit what we believe to be the oil potential in West Vestavi. Now, what's interesting is that, as you can see, Block's license is located within what we believe to be the Middle Eocene fairway, which is a fractured reservoir. Now, typically in exploiting these reservoirs, you drill horizontal wells. Now, interestingly enough, this application has only been used once in Georgia, and this was back in the early 90s. a company by the, was trading by the name of Canargo that was actually operated by a JV partner in Georgia, drilled five horizontal wells into the Middle Eocene, bringing back pretty much dead wells to commercial producers. Now the chart on the right-hand side indicates some of the production rates that were derived from that work. Well number N4 was taken from 50 barrels a day up to 850 barrels of oil a day. Now just to put things into perspective, an 850 barrel a day well offers a payback within 3 months and has a capital requirement of about $1.5 million. So the speed of your payback in Georgia, given the fiscal terms, is fantastic. The N96 well was taken from 19 barrels of oil a day up to 235. The N100 well was taken from 300 barrels of oil a day up to 590. We're taking a proven concept and we're applying it to a proven play in West Rastavi. Moving on to the gas potential. Now, as you can see, both 11B and West Rastavi are littered with gas, with successful gas tests. West Rastavi is located on the fringes of the west of the Rastavi industrial complex. It's currently consuming around 30 million cubic feet of gas a day and imports 100% of that gas from SOCAR in Azerbaijan. Georgia actually sources 100% of its gas requirements from Azerbaijan and is on a take or pay type contract and is currently seeking for domestic ways to access cheaper gas supply. As you can see, there's a low pressure line, that red line that runs through the centre of the presentation there, is a low pressure line that transports gas back into the local village of Rastavi and ties back into the high pressure line, which is around 8 kilometres away. So to summarise on the reserve resource potential and the asset base, we have 100% working interest in Noro, 90% working interest in Satskanesi, of which have been attributed a 1.1 million barrel 2P net oil reserves, in alongside 32 million barrels of contingent oil. We've currently got a 25% working interest in West Rastavi. We're earning in for 75%, and needless to say, the upside there for us is in the contingent oil resources, as well as the gas. Now, as mentioned earlier, we're currently fully funded to execute the plan over the next 18 months. Our initial phase of work is due to kick off in the next 2 or so weeks. We're in advanced negotiations on rig contracts. We've just finished inspecting the workover rig in which we're going to use throughout the Norio work program. And we're in the process of inspecting a ZJ-40 rig that's going to be performing the sidetracks in West Rastavi. Beyond the 24-month period, it's going to be focused on developing existing fields. We're going to be drilling new wells in Norio, new wells in West Rastavi, testing both the Lower Eocene, going after the gas potential, also exploiting the Middle Eocene oil potential. We'd like to see ourselves increasing existing production up to around 2,000 barrels of oil a day. And thereafter, there's plenty of additional opportunities that have been identified throughout Georgia and the wider region that we believe will fit very neatly within our investment strategy. So just a short summary on what we've done since listing. It's been an extremely busy time for all. We've increased our working interest in the West Rastavi license, which I should also add is governed by a brand new PSC. The production sharing contract has just been given an effective date of the 1st of September. We've obtained further 2D seismic throughout West Rastavi that helps validate the play and assist us in steering our horizontal wells that we plan to drill Q4, Q1 of next year. We've bolstered our technical team on the ground in Georgia and upgraded our HSE department. As explained earlier, we've just completed rig inspections. And we've identified proven well technology, which we believe will assist us in overcoming the existing wellbore damages that we're going to be faced with throughout our recompletion program. So to summarise, ladies and gentlemen, the investment case of Block Energy is pretty straightforward. We're an asset-backed with multiple undeveloped oil and gas opportunities. We're applying relevant technologies new to Georgia to unlock already identified reserves. We're in the right place in terms of asset and interest. There's significant re-rating potential with a fully funded work program moving into next year. The economics are excellent and offer our investors rapid payback. Thank you.
Paul, thanks very much indeed, and thanks for putting up with the mic going down as well. So, questions for Paul Haywood from Block Energy. Just raise your hand, and Thomas Coleman at the back will bring you our roving microphone to come to you. Yes, we have one at the back, please. Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you. You didn't mention too much about the political situation, especially the relationship with Russia and how it would affect the gas and oil prices.
Yeah, that's a very good question. Since my time in Georgia, I've witnessed the peaceful handover of power over several occasions. Relationships now, I must say, since the ousting of Misha Saakashvili, who's now is moving around the globe, has spent a significant amount of his time post-Georgia in Ukraine, has been extremely well managed. And the relationship between East and West seems to be very healthy currently. And you spending a bit of time into basically, only bypass that fact, and that sort of shitload of European money flowing in into the country, construction, it's extremely prominent throughout the centre of Tbilisi, again, from a political standpoint, things have been moving in the right direction.
Any other questions? One at the back, please.
What were the decline rates on the previous horizontal wells?
So those IPs that we presented in the presentation were annual IPs. So they weren't tested over a 3-4 day period. We've assumed a decline rate of circa 1.5 to 2% per month compounded on an annual basis. But each sidetrack for us will cost in and around the ballpark. Sorry, go
ahead.
Correct.
How long have they been in production for?
The decline rates that, that we've identified were circa 2% a month, compounded on an annual basis. The payback for these wells, assuming the production rates were achieved in Inoxminder, were within 12 months. So we don't have to, these wells typically come pretty strong. We don't have to have them producing for too long to ensure that we get our investors' money back.
All right, we have got time for a few more questions if you want. I'd like to expand on that political dimension, if I may. We've got the threat, if you like, of a potentially expansionist political regime in Russia. I mean, do you think the company's being realistic about the potential threat there? You're right on the border with Putin, eager to land grab at any moment.
Yeah, I think the 4-day split between Russia and Georgia during 2008 obviously is still pretty prominent in people's minds and is is a risk that we all see. If and when that would happen again is anybody's guess.
Yeah.
Right now, I can assure you that relationships have been kept extremely peaceful, and there is no indications in the country that we see that will lead that we may lead to.
Yeah, I guess until it happens, nobody's got a crystal ball, have they? So, in terms of infrastructure, where you are, how well served are you in Georgia?
We've been selling oil in our Loria and Saskanesi field for the part that we acquired the positions in 2017. We've made four oil sales since then, and the owner prior. Previous owner had been selling oil on a quarterly basis since 2009. So selling oil is a very well driven part. We sell oil at Brent minus $10 at wellhead, and it's the buyer's choice to handle the logistics and costs thereafter. And with regards to transportation and gas, the West Rostali permit is extremely well served. We've got a low pressure line that runs right beside our permit, and then you've also got a major SDP pipeline that runs through the centre of the country. So infrastructure is all in place.
All right. Any more questions then, anybody? Yes, there's one more here at the front, please, Thomas.
Thank you. You recently raised cash and IPO'd. You mentioned that you are sufficient or good for 18 months of operations. Could you just elaborate a little bit how this money will be spent, and could you accelerate or deaccelerate the pace? If there are any opportunities, would you be considering making acquisitions earlier than expected?
Absolutely. So we've broken the initial work program in Saskatchewan and Oreo down to bite-sized chunks, basically, for that very reason. So we're going to execute repair of three wells in Saskatchewan, which is a
pretty straightforward part of our program. It gets the rigs moving and it's team working with each other again, etc. Then we're going to move everybody over to the line, whereby we've screened over 55 wells and picked our best 10. Now, the best 10 wells have been re-entered and understood by the previous asset owner. Fortunately, he was undercapitalized, so we didn't actually perform the work he had identified. But going into this work program, we've broken down 10 work programs into a slice of four, with a four on the back end, depending on results, and we'll see where we end up, with a further two wells planned, assuming the eight-well program turns out according to plan. So we can pretty much fast-track or slow things down based on results going forward, and we've mapped out a pretty certain plan that enables us to evaluate results as we slowly move forward.
Does that answer your question? Good. All right. Go on, yeah, please, you've got time. Yeah.
Actually, was there any other key fast-track things?
Because you accelerate West will start the acquisition.
Absolutely. So we've got Sunday next door testing the exact same plane which we tested gas from in West Westerly. West well number 30 is one of the first wells we plan to retest, and we plan to do that shortly after Sunday drill, basically. And they're going after the Modus and gas plate, which is the same plate we're targeting in West Westerly. We feel we can learn a lot from what they're currently experiencing through their drill. Post retest of well number 30 for us, assuming things are as good as forecasted, then we'll expedite that plan, that's for sure.
For the moment, from Paul Haywood from Block Energy, do give him a big round of applause. Thank you.